last zinger, one last laugh, one last bow. Jon Stewart takes his leave of The Daily Show tonight. Jeffrey Brown has our look.
Whose team are we on in the Middle East?
Jon Stewart has been called the nation's satirist in chief. And recently he went at it once again with the commander in chief.
We're fighting with Iraqis to defeat ISIS, right, along with Iran. But in Yemen, we're fighting Iran with Iraqis and Saudis.
That's not quite right, but that's okay.
Who are we bombing?
It was President Obama's seventh appearance on Stewart's Daily Show and his last.
I'm issuing a new executive order that Jon Stewart cannot leave the show.
But Stewart is leaving after 16 years of a kind of faux newscast that took daily events and gave them a comedic, often pointed twist.
It's supposed to be fun, you know, the water balloons and super soakers.
A water gun at a Texas pool party? Are you trying to get me killed?
Eric Dagans is TV critic for NPR.
Jon Stewart's ultimate enemy is hypocrisy and phoniness.
Reed, how did you not read this bill?
Other late night shows are mostly focused on entertainment. The Daily Show has always been more about the news. It's been more about trying to take these things that have always seemed so serious, while also making fun of them, exposing truths that are hard to get at any other way.
In a conversation last year, as he released Rosewater, his first feature film, Stewart told me how he sees his role.
The conversation is about the space between the public face of our leaders versus the private strategies that produce that face, the facade that's placed up. The conversation is about corruption, whether it comes to governance or whether it comes to media. The satire comes from a place of urging. It comes from a place of an ideal. It's the humor only works as a counterpoint to seeing something that you feel is not at the level where you know it could be, of opportunity squandered.
Stewart would hone that approach over the years, sometimes acting goofy.
Thank you for joining me in the library, Mr. Vice President. We invaded two countries.
Sometimes angry.
We gotta do whatever we can to keep Americans safe. 9 people shot in a church. What about that?
One constant target, the media, particularly what he saw as the bloviating on cable news. Stewart and his writers would find the moment and roll the video.
This mantra of the unarmed black teenager shot by a white cop, you know, that description in and of itself actually colors the way in which we look at this story.
Yes. Describing the actual facts of the case.
An early flashpoint came in 2004 when he lambasted CNN's Crossfire.
You're doing theater when you should be doing debate, which would be great.
No, it's not honest.
Another regular target, politicians. Again, often captured in their own words.
I've been coloring my hair for years.
But politicians on both sides of the aisle sought out The Daily Show.
I'm sure you'll be much more respectful now that
conservatives might rail against what they saw as Stewart's liberal bent, but Republicans, including presidential candidate Mike Huckabee, were regulars.
But you believe that the Bubbas are better than the Bubbles?
No, different.
No, better.
He joined Stewart 9 times. New York Democratic Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, interviewed by Stewart on 5 occasions, told us how he influenced members of Congress and their staffs.
He has a great episode on something that we've been working on. We rush to watch it. That's what he certainly did on the 9/11 health bill. He took something that was really languishing the House for 7 years without any movement, gone nowhere in the Senate. He framed the issue so effectively that there wasn't a member of Congress who could stand against him, particularly in the Senate. And when we passed that bill, it was unanimous. There's so few people you can say that about. They can actually shift a national conversation.
I agree with you, John. We should be able to shoot people.
Another area of influence, members of his own comedic team, including Steve Carell, Stephen Colbert, and John Oliver, who've gone on to make their own marks.
Ignore this.
Baby's on fire again. Damn
entertainment.
Samantha Bee served as The Daily Show's longest-serving regular correspondent before leaving earlier this year.
Jon gave me the freedom to really explore areas of concern, you know, that I felt passionately about, and that was very invigorating. Jon was our benevolent overlord. There's no question. But working on The Daily Show changed my life profoundly. Typically, if he was pushing us in a direction, he's pushing us in the direction of elevating the joke.
His success is due to the fact that he just worked his ass off and he really cares.
Current Daily Show correspondent Al Madrigal shared this anecdote with us.
At one point during a Daily Show field piece, I started spinning like Wonder Woman almost in between cities, and for no reason whatsoever. And I remember him just laughing out loud in the screening and going, that doesn't make any sense. I love it. Like, go for it.
Not everything was rosy, it seems. Former Daily Show correspondent Wyatt Cenac recently claimed that Stewart blew up at him for questioning the racial overtones of a skit. Cenac was the only black writer on the program at the time. Another recent report by Politico that Stewart met with the president twice at the White House shows the stature he attained beyond the television screen. Years into the faux news era, there's also a question for the media industry about young people who came to rely on The Daily Show for their news.
We're training a nation of information consumers to expect that really affecting reporting also has to be really entertaining and fun to consume.
The Pope is on Ricola.
As cool as it is to see what Jon Stewart has put together, some news stories are not entertaining, but people still need to know the information and they still need to access it to be better citizens.
I smell a new Pixar movie.
In the meantime, some things don't change. As he departs, Jon Stewart is having great fun with the 2016 presidential race, just as he did when he spoke to us at the 2000 Democratic National Convention.
I think there's always comic fodder in bad theater, and especially bad theater that has the mandate to matter and not be superficial. So I think that's probably good fodder. But individuals are not, I don't think we're necessarily making fun of individuals. We're making fun of more of a process than anything else.
Jon Stewart hasn't said what's next for him. Perhaps picking up on one of The Daily Show's signature pieces, his own personal moment of zen.
It's like you won't really be gone.
I'm not dying. I'm just leaving the show.
Whatever you have to tell yourself, man.
For the PBS NewsHour, I'm Jeffrey Brown.
Check online for a list of the times Jon Stewart or his colleagues have actually influenced policy in Washington.